In the whole barefoot shoes debate, or even better, the controversy between minimal and maximal, these big, thick, super cushioned shoes, a lot of people want to see the research, and I think that's a great idea, unless you actually know how to read the research. Let me show you what I mean. I've got two studies here that I'm going to pull up that show something that I find utterly, utterly mind-blowing. Let's move me to the bottom right-hand corner, and now we're going to be taking a look at this one study. You can look it up if you want. And I'm going to highlight something that really blows my mind, and it says almost everything you need to know about the quality of studies for running injuries and footwear. And it starts here. However, despite advancements in research and subsequent improvements in running footwear design over the years, that's the setup, but check out the punchline. The rates of running injuries have not decreased. Now, is it just me, or is the idea that if the rate of running injuries have not actually decreased in roughly the last 50 years, that there are not really improvements in research and design in running shoes? Again, maybe it's just me, but let's take a look at another one. I'm going to move me to, where am I going to put me on the bottom left now? And so we're going to go past this whole unbelievably meaningless thing, advancements in research and improvements in running footwear design, running injuries. All right, let's go to the second one. This is really fun too. The influence of barefoot and barefoot-inspired footwear on the kinetics and kinematics of running and blah, 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 blah. Let's just count down to my favorite part. You know, if you're going to do a study that involves people who are running barefoot, you would want people who know how to run barefoot, I'm guessing. So let's take a look at what they did in this study to find people who really could, you know, where they could test running in regular shoes in the form that you have there against what happens when you're barefoot. Participants were non-habitual barefoot runners and thus given time to accommodate to the barefoot and barefoot-inspired footwear prior to the commencement of data collection. That is awesome. But again, here's the punchline. This involved 5 minutes of running. Sorry, I don't know how to get rid of that. 5 minutes of running through the testing area without concern for striking the force platform. Once again, you know, is it just me, or do you think that 5 minutes of switching from a shoe that you've been using for years to a shoe that will undeniably change your gait or inspire you to is actually enough to get real information? I'm going to go for no for a couple reasons. So first of all, habitual shod runners typically, not always, but we didn't know here, because let me pause right there. The magic thing is form, not footwear. It's the bottom line. What happens to your form? Is that form beneficial for effective running, beneficial for reducing injury, beneficial for building strength, beneficial recovery, or not? What I can tell you is if you're running barefoot, bad form hurts, good form feels good. If you're running in shoes that look like this with a big thick heel that elevates your heel as well, or something that's even twice as thick, you can run with bad form and not know until it's too late. What do I mean by bad form? I was at an event recently. It's called the Mountain Land Running Summit, a bunch of researchers about running injuries, their cause and cure. And for the first time ever, they all agreed that the number one cause of running injuries, or leading to running injuries, is overstriding, landing with your foot too far in front of your body, because that's putting on the brakes every time you land, and it's sending force somewhere, not necessarily in an ideal place, because if your leg is relatively straight and you're landing on your heel, all the force is going through your joints up into your, well, rather bypassing your muscles, ligaments, and tendons. So going into your ankle, into your knee, into your hip, into your back, and whichever one is the weakest link in that chain, that's where you're probably going to find some problems. But again, it might be too late because you don't have a lot of nerve receptors in those joints that are telling you, ow, 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 ow. If you're using your muscles, ligaments, and tendons, they're designed to protect those joints. And what that means by using your muscles, ligaments, and tendons, landing with your foot more underneath your center of mass, typically flat-footed, midfoot, forefoot, arguments about that that aren't relevant right now. But when you're doing that, you're landing with your knee a little bent. In fact, your ankle is a little bit behind your knee, so you have a bent knee with your foot mostly underneath your body, using all those muscles, ligaments, and tendons properly. So, what was the point of this? Where was I going? All right, so if you switch from running like this in a big thick shoe with landing on your heel to a barefoot shoe or running barefoot, that's going to be a gait change that you're not used to. And that can be problematic, especially, or, well, it's even crazier. I've seen people not change their gait at all, and they're still running barefoot, landing on their heel, foot out in front of them. Or they hear that they're supposed to land on the ball of their foot, so they land with their foot way out in front of them and point their toes. Even more problematic, because then you're putting stress on the metatarsals, the bones in your foot, they're not being supported by the muscles, ligaments, and tendons in your foot. So, two bits of research that sum up almost everything I can think of, but I'm going to quote one other that I don't have in front of me. And that is one of the bits of research that catalyzed this whole big, thick running shoe movement, or was in the argument about barefoot versus cushioned shoes way back when, done here at the University of Colorado by someone who I bought a beer for to talk about the research. And I said, I think there's two problems with your research. By the way, this guy did not like that, even with a beer in his hand. The first, I said, you only had 12 people. It's not telling a whole lot. And what he was testing was running barefoot versus running on a treadmill that had some cushioning on it. By the way, Nike-supported lab, and the foam came from Nike. I'm not saying that that tainted the results. I am saying that in pharmaceutical research, we know that independent research gives very different results than research sponsored by the pharmaceutical company that's testing the drug in question. Be that as it may, my two next points are still relevant. 12 people in the study, not very many. I don't know why I did this when I said 12. But the other one is this. The study said that it used accomplished barefoot runners. So what I said to this researcher over our last beer together is, I know all the barefoot runners in town. I am one of the barefoot runners in town. You know me. Neither I nor anyone that I know who's an accomplished barefoot runner was in your study. My suspicion is that the people in your study were accomplished runners who do a little bit of running on their bare feet in the infield of a track when they're done with their long distance training. What I can tell you is, if you can't run enjoyably in bare feet on cement for at least a mile, you are not an accomplished barefoot runner. Look, I'm a sprinter. I don't like running anything more than 100 meters, and even I can do that. So again, neither I nor the people that I know were in that study. So I agree that the research is really important, but you've got to know how to read the research and see, does this make sense at all? Does A lead to B? I mean, this idea that running shoes have gotten better, but injuries have not changed, that kind of puts a bit of a spin on everything else that's being said, because that just makes no sense. This whole idea that 5 minutes of transition is more than enough to have a completely new gait pattern, seems, and do that reliably and efficiently and effectively and enjoyably, seems a little unlikely. Having 12 people who are, quote, accomplished barefoot runners, but without knowing who they are or what makes them accomplished, that's a problem as well. So I hope someday there is the Holy Grail study where it's a large group of people, some of whom are running in whatever they've been running in, some of whom are just asked to try some minimalist shoes, and some are asked to try minimalist shoes and given a really smart methodology for switching to them safely, and then test them every 3, 6, 12 months, see what happens over a longer period of time. Now, I can tell you from looking at the reviews on Xeroshoes.com and Xeroshoes.eu and Xeroshoes.co.uk, we got a really good suspicion about how that's going to pan out, but it'd be really helpful to get the research nonetheless. Anyway, that's my rant. Dying to hear what you think about it. Put it in the comments below and let the conversation continue.